Hello and welcome back to Let's Play Cayne. More of the birthing labs. Sounds wonderful.
Jesus.
You're scared.
Heck yeah, I'm scared.
Jeez, we have fire too.
Please. Create this.
Monsters.
Welcome to Cayne. So we've got a voice recorder, and there's a PDA over here. Personal diary lies idle. An authoritative voice broadcasts from the tiny recording device. Oh, it does. Floating corpse. Lacerated ribbons of flesh and muscle tissue frame the shattered vertebrae like some grotesque work of art. A mangled PDT clings to the spinal cord. Okay, so we want to get this to help make our own PDT. Viscous nutrient suit. Soup. Unidentifiable clumps of gore and other organic matter heave and churn languidly in the vat. Ugh. Burning machinery. Acrid black smoke loops between the melted circuitry and plastic. Restraining harness. For what? Tangled thermonylon strapping and mangled clamps dangled ominously from the massive reinforced steel frame. Was a whip? A strip of leather sways gently. Apparently we can get that. Organic fluids. It smells like an abattoir. Slaughterhouse. Hydraulic mechanism. It looks like it's attached to something submerged in that stuff. I assume we want to work that thing. Oh, this thing hanging down. So maybe we can get that. The whip covers, well, this whole thing. Maybe they're trying to make it less, what do you call it? Pixel hunting. Lever. The control box is connected to the hydraulic mechanism in the vat. Is there any other way out of here? No. Apparently not. Can I get this whip? So weird. That voice. A bloodstained whip with tiny burrs.
On second thought, nope. I think not.
Okay, sorry. Check out this PDA. Professor John Kearn. Oh, this is John
they
that you mentioned.
Growing someone.
I haven't read it yet.
We're trying to grow Cayne.
Cloning is unpredictable. Cloning an individual is impossible.
It sounds like they were using something special. Something called Samantha.
Mm-hmm. Today is a holy day, February 9th. Hendry Cayne himself has arrived, frozen and waiting for the great harvest to come. Soon the flesh of the immortal vessel will bring him new life. We're closer than ever, and I know it. The race has begun, and I will not allow Dr. Adams, the heretic he is, to win. No, Cayne will not allow it. He knows his plan, and he knows that it ends with me. Our Leviathan is Samantha. Nothing on earth is her equal. A creature without fear. The Book of Job, 41:33. He's a little off his gourd. February 14th. Oh, it's Valentine's Day. Never again will he die. Never again will he feel pain. Never again will he leave us. He will be reborn of his own duplicate flesh, and not that of Adams in his ridiculous mind transfer parlor trick. Okay, he really doesn't like Adams. Heretic. Right. March 13th. We're getting closer. Our next patient has undergone the new and improved genetic fusion procedure and is reacting well. The spinal cord has been killed, meaning that the dead cells will need to regenerate and reform into a functioning spine. No signs of physical rejection thus far, and cellular regeneration is slowly beginning. It should reconstruct itself overnight. Next day, March 14th. Our Lord has stricken us with inadequacy. We have failed yet again. This is my fault, and I must, as always, accept responsibility. This time I've added hooks to my whip, and I shall flagellate until dawn. What? I will elaborate on the results after I've taken time to reflect. Okay, so this is the whip we just picked up? Wonderful. March 15th. Fusing Samantha's DNA with the patient's caused the newly regenerated spinal cord to expand drastically, forcing the vertebrae to audibly pop into even halves. Vertebra? Okay. Soon after, the patient's immune system attacked the rogue spinal cells, which in turn retaliated by killing off all the other attached nerves. In the end, the patient succumbed to asphyxiation as the new cells burned through oxygenated blood more quickly than the lungs could produce it. Another failure, but still not a wasted body. Got a lot of entries. April 8th. Praise be! I've spent the day, or at least most of it, reflecting on our Savior's brilliant plan. The pieces slide into place. Samantha, myself, and the almighty Cayne in the same facility. The planets are aligning. The end draws near. Or perhaps the beginning? May 13th. I'm glad we have finally found a use for Ralph. Who's Ralph? We have put him to a more productive task. Ha! His blasphemous lectures about how the fungal plague is a result of poor hygiene were getting on my nerves. It is Cain's doing. The plague is his retribution for our sins. May 30th. Tonight we test again. We'll be using the same procedure as before, but this time an enzyme inhibitor will be introduced to prevent excess tissue generation. We must not accept failure. We will bask in the light of Cain's restored glory. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Revelation 2:11. June 8th. Still, the patient lives. However, it has exhibited some concerning symptoms. Although the spinal cord has stopped regenerating at an appropriate time, the arms and legs will occasionally twitch, or more accurately, flail. It seems that the spine has control over the connected limbs. Well, that's a good thing, generally. June 11th. The patient is no longer viable. After a promising start, the regenerative tissue again expanded beyond intention. Surprisingly, the patient's removed vocal cords were reconstructed. Of course, it did not understand speech. It must have been frightened by its own inhuman screaming, as it immediately tore its own throat out. Okay. After some gurgling, it regenerated within hours. Then terrible screaming and bloody extraction. A cascade of rotting tissue, the previous throats began to form a dangling, bleeding scarf, as the patient continued to tear itself apart. Oh my God. July 1st. Oh, that abomination! As far as Sharon can tell, Adam's unrighteous creation has wasted precious flesh in making a toy of some kind. Just like its creator, the abomination has been an unholy waste of resources. Even a name such as Hobo is an undeserved grace. It is an animal, and nothing more. Adam's creation. August 13th. Pestilence strikes. The fungal threat is weak now, but soon it will spread to our food and to our bodies, if it hasn't already. This is our first and perhaps final warning to make haste. I've traced the spores to a cargo shipment earlier in the year, but I have no idea how they become so virulent. Behold, with a great plague will Cayne smite thy people and thy children and all thy goods. 2 Chronicles 21:14. I don't think that's actually would be in the Bible. It's talking about Cayne. August 29th. The fungus is having an observable impact on the cellular regeneration process. One patient began to develop a film of what resembled reptilian scales, complete with a secondary set of eyelids. This is unacceptable. The spinal regeneration process has been mastered. Almost any tissue can now be perfectly reconstructed, but it's impossible to get definitive results with this interference. Cayne, if you truly seek rebirth, why do you hinder me so? Is this not the time? Surely there is a reason. October 12th. Samantha scratched several demonic scrawls into an insignificant employee's back. I warned them not to get close to the succubus. She is the devil. Sometimes we need to make a deal with hell to get closer to heaven. September 18th. Forgive me, Cayne. I succumbed to Sharon's temptation and had a romantic dinner rather than working late. as I should have done. Watch and pray that ye not enter not into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. 1 Timothy 6:11 to 12. My repetitive failure has indeed had an impact on faith, on my faith. I am being tested. For the love of Cayne, I shall rise above. December 4th. Today I noticed that my laboratory is missing several incubators. The last inventory check was several months ago, so it could have gone missing at any time. This is undoubtedly the work of Adams, but why? He doesn't need the equipment, and I can certainly spare it. Perhaps the hobo is involved? It is disconcerting at best. So the hobo, I think, is one of Adams' creations? I don't know. December 15th. Time is of the essence. Samantha's escape today is likely to be the first of many, and we will eventually run out of ways to subdue her. The re-engineered grubs are producing a potent gas that is driving the beast to fluster. Whether she kills us all or we find a way to kill her first, neither outcome revives Cayne. I will not rest until he has returned to intervene. From this point forward, I live for nothing else. I guess after this you stop living, because it was your last entry. So Samantha escaped. And that's interesting, because we're really talking about Samantha a lot more. And we never got to find Samantha, at least not as far as I know. She was at one point in that iron lung, and we did see the iron lung. But I don't know if she's still in there, or she was still in there. So they're producing a gas that's driving the beast to fluster. That's Hendry Cayne, isn't it? H.C. Hendry Cayne himself has arrived. Is that his own necklace? So he took it off Cayne's corpse and put it on himself? I thought it was Henry Cayne, not Hendry. Typo, maybe? So what is this restraining? What about this voice recorder? It's John Kearn.
John Kearn. Note to self. All that have not fins and scales in the seas and in the rivers, of all that move in the waters, and of any living thing which is in the waters, they shall be an abomination unto you. Leviticus 9:10.
Okay, that's wonderful. The powerful voice of John Kearn instructs. Note to self, okay, it's just repeating what it said. 9:10.
Hadley, what would your mother say? On second thought, nope.
Alright, let's pull the lever. See what is in there. I'm guessing. What the hell?
That was nasty.
That's a huge body. Oh, this is a womb? Or I thought it was like a chest, like breasts and a uterus made of flesh and machine. What the hell am I supposed to do with that? Now with this whip, maybe I can drag the body over and get the PDT? I want that. Hmm. What am I supposed to do with this? It's time to whip it. Whip it good. Can I still interact with the lever? No. Not sure what we can do here. Let's head to the crew quarters. Maybe there we can. Excuse me, one of these two. Maybe at the crew quarters we can find something to drag that body out and grab the PDT. We need a blank PDT as well. And a PDT imprint or something? And something else. Some kind of cryogenic thing. Brain emulation, we don't have that yet. Crew facilities. Play, flag, power, flag.
It worked!
This can't be how I meet my end. I have so much more inside of me.
That doesn't sound good.
I have so much more to give to the world.
Yep, this wasn't my plan either. This wasn't how it was supposed to be.
You're young. You can get through this.
If I don't die.
And then? I'm stuck. Stuck with a baby. It's not a life. Not fair for either of us.
There are other choices.
Well, the baby.
Bingo! I did make a choice. It didn't end well.
Who's the father?
Women in my family have bad luck with babies. I'm continuing a proud family tradition.
That and beginning cinematic, we saw that the they mentioned that the procedure was paid for by a third party. So, I'm guessing she went to get an abortion or something. Because she obviously doesn't want the baby. Crew facilities.
So, this is where the monsters play.
Chuka-Cola.
Still no sign of anyone?
Do plants count? This horrible place must have had more people around.
It did. Holographic eye? It's seen things you wouldn't believe. Holographic tin of Juca-Cola. Who needs sleep? Juca-Cola. It's refreshing, addictive. And addictive? May cause chronic insomnia, headaches, vomiting, diarrhea, nausea, hallucinations, hypertension, gastrointestinal bleeding, peripheral neuropathy, cardiac dysrhythmia, congestive heart failure, toxic epidermal necrolysis, catastrophic hemorrhage, and death. Save the best for last. Holographic notice board. The menu's ready-to-eat items include the space soup and space special. The drab cheap plastic mundanity of this crew lounge is but a moment's respite from the horrors unfolding around it. A retro tape cassette is loaded into the deck with the label Brosef Mega Mix number 69. Bent stripper pole? The steel pole is damaged, but probably still useful, somehow. We can use that to grab the body, I guess. Scented greenhouse. Leafy aromatic shrubs are flourishing in the otherwise somewhat unkept or unkempt terrarium. Hadley.
Can I get a J-O-S-E-P-H? Yeah.
Joseph?
Goes on. Don't forget.
For Joseph. I mean, just a holographic can? I mean, why? I want to read the notice board. So there's another area you can go in as well. Can I get the cassette? It's like an interact with it.
Maybe if I rotate it sideways. No.
I can put the voice recorder in. Why?
Voice file captured.
Can I get a J-O-S-E-P-H?
Joseph Brino. Okay, maybe we need his voice to get past, maybe into his quarters. It recognizes his voice. The voice recording device contains a voice sample of Joseph Brino. Alright, that's good.
I think not.
Alright, bent stripper pole. Got it. Well, now I can move to other items. The politically correct term is exercise pole. Yeah. Okay, that's neat. Alright, what we got in here? Crew quarters? Thanks for letting me know. Layers of ash on the floor resemble thick carpet. Twisted wreck of an elevator. Smashed glass and scrap metal. Not much else. The steel wreckage radiates an immense amount of heat. The air above it hazy and distorted. Locked crew quarters. This apartment belongs to Cindy Milan? Dr. Milan's daughter, I guess? Or wife? Blood streaks the threshold like a red carpet. The name on the hologram reads Awesome Danny Boland. Huh. This one's unknown. Locked crew quarters door. Ripped open door. Even the frame and the walls are buckled and broken as if by some furious preternatural force. Samantha, I presume? The private journal has been knocked to the floor. Passageway. That's not ominous at all. It's not. There's no name on the holographic display. Overgrown gardens. A flourishing extravagance of verdant flora, unconcerned by the catastrophe around it. Dense oxygen gardens. The facility uses these hydroponic houses as a natural, unmechanical method of replenishing its oxygen supplies. Alright. Inclined metal floor. An incredible force has bent the platform. I'm supposed to jump down from there or something? Oh, the apartment belongs to Dr. S. Adams. Cindy Milan. Well, obviously, it's not gonna work. We need to find Joseph's apartment. For there, we need to jump down, huh? Or jump over. Right next to the flames, huh? Do I need to cut my way through the fence or something?
No.
Okay, sorry.
If I turn around, it may fit. Probably not.
It makes her breathe. Well, we can't access this stuff. Let's try in here. Ooh. God.
Oh, terribly decorated.
Yeah, with blood. Personal diary sits idle. Shattered picture frame. It's a portrait of an old man in a white laboratory coat. The blood-sodden sheets have dried like a scab over the bunk. Discarded equipment. A small light illuminates the device on the floor. Vintage photographs. Sterile polyester vignettes of some other place, some other time. Must be nicer than here. Mangled electronic safe. It looks like the door has been chewed off its hinges. Okay, whose place was this? The damaged radio blares a static tune. Personal terminal. Burnt out circuitry smolders behind the smashed screen. Romance novels? Titles like Bride of the Omniverse, The Cosmonaut's Mistress, and An Interstellar Scandal are still legible through the blots of gore. This is more than just from one person. One person does not have this much blood. Anything else? Is this supposed to be like a TV monitor or something? So someone really wanted to get into that safe. What about this equipment? She won't run. I don't blame her. Blank BDT!
And it looks unused.
How do you know?
No blood on it. And it doesn't smell like rotting meat.
So hopefully we don't have to attach it to our own spinal cord. It's an empty PDT. Okay, one of the three things we need. Alright, let's see whose PDA is this. Joseph Buenos? Oh no, this is Julia Kearn. February 6th. Daddy is anxious. She's weird looking too. He won't admit it, but I think the idea of having Cayne in stasis here bothers him. He knows his work is coming along slowly. He's scared to fail in his holy light, but knows that he will. Poor Daddy. March 14th. Oh, that's Sharon. I'm sure it's her temptation that is leading my daddy to failure. She keeps him from punishing himself like he should. Oh my god. She scolds me for calling him Daddy because she thinks I'm too old. Excuse me, but I was raised with a little thing called values. Besides, she wants me to call her Mom. Double standards, right? Pretty much. March 23rd. Joseph is so special. Do you ever feel like something is just meant to be? It is such a tacky feeling to describe, but it's true. It's cliché for a reason. How can you have nostalgia over someone you just saw a couple of minutes ago? I don't know, but it's the best feeling in the world. Babysitting Samantha's brood is easier when I know I can go see him afterwards. Because she's talking about Joseph Bueno? Yeah. Bino, I don't know. Bueno is spelled differently. March 23rd, April 4th. Ugh. Another day, a little leather load of brood gas harvested. I understand that we need it to keep Samantha calm, but it's such a pain to watch over her oversized maggots. Of course, why bother with the gas when we can just stick Sharon in there to calm her down just as well? They look about the same anyway. Haha. Did I mention how much I hate working with this bitch? It is bad enough that she is screwing my daddy, but I have to work with her every single day. Okay, so I now know what we need to do, pretty much sure. Why we want to adjust the temperature to 95 or over 95? Because we want the maggots or grubs or whatever to produce this gas again so that we can keep Samantha from killing us, I guess. That might have been Samantha we ran into. It's a hybrid. To keep her calm so we can get to the elevator. Guessing. Or wherever we're gonna run into her. April 5th, next day. Time to vent. I've really been thinking about how Samantha only lets Sharon handle her, and it pisses me off to no end. Joseph could cheat on me, and I'd still be angry about Sharon and her stupid lopsided face. I wish that witch would stop trying to micromanage my family. May 1st. The 1st of May is always so romantic. Spring is here. I mean, it probably is somewhere or another. There aren't really seasons here. Sometimes the atmospheric controls break and tries to either freeze or burn us to death, though. That counts as seasons, I think. June 8th. It's a tough life. Nothing can ever just be okay, you know? If somebody isn't sick, you can bet they're tired or hungry or stressed out. There's nowhere I'd rather be, though. Most people don't get to live with their daddy forever, much less a 5-minute walk from their perfect boyfriend. Plus, I'm working for a righteous cause. It's all worth it. August 14th. Ew, fungus. They say it's all inside the ventilation system, and now it's starting to settle on the outside of the vents. Maybe that's why everyone's got food poisoning. How long has this stuff been around? It smells like old feet. September 9th. Work's getting even harder for Daddy now that this fungus is everywhere. I have just a thing, though. I can make sure Dr. Adams doesn't use this as an opportunity to get ahead. Tonight, I'll level the playing field. Joseph likes to bring me into Adam's workspace when we get really romantic. I'm sure he won't notice if some information gets deleted, right? Now I have Joseph's voice file for some reason. I'm guessing it's to get into his quarters, wherever they are, might be. Or however we can get to them. October 4th. Sharon says her face is so disfigured because she had a stroke and lost control of the muscles that are supposed to hold the right side of it together. I'd have a stroke, too, if I had to live knowing that I was such a helpless idiot. Except I'd do the right thing and just off myself so that the rest of the gene pool didn't have to deal with me. I just let it out. You know, don't keep it to yourself. Well, I guess she was keeping it to herself. October 23rd. It's been a really long time since Daddy's told me a story about Mommy. When I was a teenager, he put me to sleep every night with a story about the two of them before I was born, and how happy they were. He denies it, but I think her death has a lot to do with his decision to practice medicine. Now, though, he insists it was his calling from Cayne since he was a child, and that Mommy was just an insignificant cog in the machine of life. I understand. Everyone copes differently. December 11th. Dr. Adams has done it. He's mapped Cayne's mind into a new host. No rejection. This isn't how it's supposed to happen. Daddy just needs more time. I've rewritten the results and updated the ARM computer with Joseph's login details, but I'm not sure how long I can keep this up. Cayne, help us all. Okay. So obviously, Mr. Kearn or Dr. Kearn, they were working on different ways to bring Cayne back, and they, not sure why exactly they're having some kind of competition over who can do it by doing it in different ways. He mapped Cayne's mind into a new host. Next day, December 12th. Joseph struck me hard across the face. Does he know that I've been sabotaging their research? He called me Grublina while he ravaged me with some over-the-knee spanking and whips lightly across my back. Does he still love me? Oh, I know he does. What? People are so weird. December 15th. It's a blessing from Cayne. Samantha broke free today and killed 5 security guards. Why is this good? I managed to sneak over to Ralph during the commotion and print a PDT. I used Joseph's high security clearance details, Also managed to grab a blank one. I'll save it for a rainy day. What's mine now? So she's printed one already. Which shows us high security clearance details. Oh, Ralph is the one who prints the PDT computer or something. December 17th. Daddy hasn't slept in 3 whole days. He barely eats. And what has Sharon done? She's distracted him. He needs to focus on Cayne. Maybe it's time I finally give her what she deserves. Joseph has been cold towards me despite me submitting to another beating and some light strangulation. December 19th. Bueno and I are over. The bastard. He admitted to me that Adams paid him earlier this year to bleep a young girl. Was she prettier than me? Does she believe that pain is pleasure? No. No, this cannot continue. December 23rd. I'll lure Sharon over to Samantha's cell and use Joseph's PDT to release Samantha on her. I just need a little human flesh to get the broodlings buzzing, and Samantha will do the rest. With the security thinned after the incident, nobody will ever find out. Even if they do figure it out, Joseph will get the blame. So use human flesh to get the broodlings buzzing. December 25th, Christmas! This is it. The power has just turned off for maintenance or something. I've decided to take care of that Sharon and I could set things straight for Daddy. Praise be to Cayne. Yeah, 4 times. Interesting.